of the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We are in the book of Samuel, and you guys, perhaps if you grew up in Sunday school, you're familiar with the story about David and Goliath. You're familiar with David and Goliath, and you're familiar also with the anointing when it comes to scripture. But just as David, glory be to God, when you pay attention of his life, it seems like he didn't have it easy. Even though Bible scholars believe that he was considered to be, if not the greatest king, one of the greatest king in Israel. But it seems like David answering the call of God on his life, it seems like all of hell break loose. Doesn't it seem like that for you sometimes? All of a sudden, you're minding your business. You're doing your own stuff. You're going about life, business. But as soon as you decide to answer the call of God on your life, it seems like all of hell break loose. It seems like things start to go downhill. It seems like things start to go bad. All of a sudden, your best friend turn on you. All of a sudden, family members are rejecting you. All of a sudden, your children are acting up as soon as you begin to answer the call of God upon your life. All of a sudden, your manager, your boss, making your life miserable. As soon as you decide to answer the call of God on your life. Before that, things were smooth in your perspective. You understand life was good. But as soon as I say yes to God, it seems like trouble is on the rise. But I want you to understand, just as God called you, he will anoint you. And the Bible said, I want you to understand that the call of God and the anointing of God, it seems like it's associated with each other. I want you to understand, if God calls you, he will anoint you. I want you to tell yourself, I'm anointed for this. Come on, touch yourself. Say, I'm anointed for this. Yes, come on, say, I'm anointed for this. Because sometimes we feel that what we are dealing with is so overwhelming. What we are dealing with is we can't handle it. But I want you to understand, God has anointed you for this. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. So when we look throughout the scripture in the Old Testament, when we talk about the anointing, the Hebrew word for anoint is mashal. When we look throughout the Old Testament, the scripture, we will see when they're about to anoint, they will take the oil. When they're about to anoint someone, an individual, a religious ceremony, they will take oil to anoint that particular individual. Oil is not the anointing, but oil symbolizes the anointing. In fact, in the Old Testament, God's Spirit is the one that anoints the individual. In the New Testament, we are anointed by the Holy Ghost. So when we look at the anointing, what is the anointing then? The anointing is the enablement for you to complete a task. I want you to understand this, that when God anoints you, he enables you to complete a task. That's why you have to make up in your mind that I will fulfill the calling of God on my life. You have to understand and declare, I will fulfill the purpose of God on my life. Because the anointing is the enablement to complete something. When God anoints you, he enables you to complete something. Praise the name of the Lord. And you have to understand the anointing, glory be to God, it enables you, and then the anointing consecrates you. The anointing enables you to complete a task, and then it sets you apart to do the task. And that's why I want you to understand, when God anoints you, you can't just act ordinary. When God anoints you, you can't just behave like the world. When God anoints you, he consecrates you and he sets you apart for service. He enables you to complete the task and he sets you apart to complete the task. Praise the name of the Lord. Clap your hands for Jesus. So he anoints you to enable you. He anoints you to set you apart. He consecrates you. And if you look throughout the scripture in the Old Testament, there are three offices that God would anoint. The first office that God would anoint is the prophets. In the Old Testament, you will see that God will anoint the prophets because he will enable them and set them apart to prophesy. He will enable them and set them apart to declare, thus saith the Lord. And when we're dealing with the prophetic, we are not just dealing with calling out names and number. We are dealing with declaring what's on the mind of God, the heart of God, and the will of God for his people. So the anointing will be upon the prophets. They were set apart and they were enabled to prophesy. The second office they would anoint was the priest. In the Old Testament, they would anoint the priest for service. They were enabled and set apart to intercede and pray on behalf of the nation of Israel. So the prophets were anointed, the priests were anointed. And you gotta remember, you are enabled to complete a task. You were set apart to complete a task. And then also the king were anointed. The kings were anointed. Bless the name of the Lord. And the kings were anointed to make a declaration. The kings were anointed to make a decree. Because you have to understand, the word of God said, decree a thing and it shall be established. Well, it was referring to the kings, because in the scripture in the Old Testament, when the king make a decree, it can't be overturned. According to the laws of the Medes and the Persian, when King Nebuchadnezzar threw Daniel in the lion's den, he couldn't even overturn his decree. He had to wait and see if Daniel going to make it out the lion's den. Glory be to God. And that's to show you how powerful a declaration is made. So that's why the kings were anointed to make a decree. Praise the name of the Lord. I'm going somewhere with this, guys. Stay with me, because I want you to understand you are anointed for this. Hallelujah. Don't allow that situation to overwhelm you. Don't allow that problem to break you. Don't allow that what you're dealing with, hallelujah, to have you weeping and having a pity party, because God has enabled you, glory be to God, to overcome. Bless the name of the Lord. So the anointing enables you. The anointing consecrates you. And I want you to understand, the anointing, hallelujah, unifies. The anointing completes. But the anointing don't compete. I want you to understand that the anointing complete don't compete. That's why you are anointed and you are anointed and you are anointed. And when we all come together with our anointing, we could have an anointing yoke destroying service. Praise the name of the Lord, because we didn't come here to compete. We come here to complete. We come here to destroy some yokes. We come here to lift some burdens. We come here to break some barrier. Because of the anointing, the yoke shall be destroyed. So the anointing, glory be to God, it completes. Bless the name of the Lord. But the anointing also has an order. In Psalm 133 verse 2 it says, it's like the precious ointment upon the head of Aaron that run down to his beard, even to Aaron, to the dung on his garments. You have to understand, when they would anoint the priest in the Old Testament, the anointing first comes from the head. That's why you must understand, the anointing starts with leadership. If you're in leadership, if you have any kind of leadership skill, the anointing, glory be to God, if you're leading with the anointing, there must be a level of responsibility. When you're anointed in leadership, there must be a level of responsibility. Folks must be able to call upon you. Folks must be able to trust you when you're dealing with the anointing. Then it says the anointing run down to the beard of Aaron. When you're dealing with the beard now, it signifies maturity. When you're anointed, there must be a level of maturity. You can't be a novice. You can't be inexperienced. You got to be able to deal with pressure. You got to be able to deal with life circumstances, because there must be a level of maturity when it comes with the anointing. Then it says it's run straight down to the garment of the priest. And if you pay attention, it's the lowest part, glory be to God, hallelujah, of the priest, the anointing. In fact, if you pay attention, the Bible said that the anointing literally rests in the hem of the garment in the priest, showing the lowliness. So when you're anointed, there must be a level of humility also. In fact, the more humble you are, the more grace God is going to give you. Because God resists the proud and he gives grace to the humble. When you understand that the anointing sits in the garment of the priest, then you will understand. That's why the woman with the issue of blood was healed. She understood if she could just touch the hem of Jesus' garment, because the anointing was resting there, she was made whole. Praise the name of the Lord. Clap your hands for Jesus. I want you to understand now, the anointing is inviolable. The anointing is not to be dishonored. Hallelujah. What I love about God, when God decides to anoint you, he needs no man approval. When God decides to anoint you, it doesn't matter what folks say, they can't un-anoint you. When God decides to anoint you, jealousy can't un-anoint you. When God decides to anoint you, bad mind can't un-anoint you. When God decides to anoint you, it doesn't matter who they are or where they're located, they can't un-anoint you. The only person that can lift the anointing off of you is God. And he will only lift the anointing off of you if you're not living a lifestyle that is required of him. Praise the name of the Lord. Then I want you to understand the anointing is personal and positional. The anointing is personal. When God anoints you, it's personal. It's a personal relationship. And this personal anointing is the one that allows you to hunger and thirst after righteousness. This personal anointing that's upon your life, this is the one that allows you to seek after God, to go after God, to fast, to pray, to study his word, because this is the anointing that keeps you connected to God. And that's why David said, Lord, create in me a clean heart and renew the right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, O Lord, and take not your spirit from me, because that's the personal anointing he's talking about. And then there is the positional anointing. That's the anointing for the office. And that's what God will anoint you for, an office, for a position. Praise the name of the Lord. And with this anointing, David understood it, because he said, I will not even touch the Lord's anointing, nor do his prophet no harm. Bless the name of the Lord. That's the anointing for a position. That's the anointing, glory be to God, that God could put you in whatever position that you're in. God could anoint you for that. Bless the name of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Clap your hands for Jesus. So now we're going to talk about Saul, David, and Goliath. And oftentimes when we hear about David and Goliath, we fail to realize that David wasn't only fighting one giant. He had to fight two giants. Saul was actually a giant in his life. And when we look at the story of David, when we pay attention to David, in the book of Samuel, at this particular time, Israel found themselves disobeying God. And when they disobeyed God, the enemy trapped them. The enemy held them. The enemy had them in captives. And God had to raise up judges to bring them out of bondage. But Israel seems like they keep rebelling against God until it came into the dispensation of the kings. And I'm telling you, glory be to God. In fact, God was their king, but the nation Israel was looking at the other nations and they're telling God, we want a king like the other nations. In other words, what they were moving from theocracy to monarchy. They were moving from God to man. And it shows sometimes that people could put their faith and trust in men more than God. This is the nation of Israel. They say, we want a king like the other nations. And this is what God said. God said, because you asked for a king, I'm going to give you a king. And if you pay attention to the name Saul interpretation, the name Saul means asked for. And this is what the people of Israel, they asked for a king. And I've come to understanding now that the voice of the people is not the voice of God. The voice of popularity is not the voice of God. The voice of fame is not the voice of God. Because the people wanted a king, but God had an appointed king for them, but they wanted a king. It's interesting that the people will accept what God rejects and reject what God accepts. God had already rejected Saul, but the people wanted him. Bless the name of the Lord. And that's why he had to tell Samuel, how long will you mourn over Saul? Don't you know I've rejected him? Go and anoint me a king in Jesse's house. And the Bible said that the prophet Samuel now, he's going down to the city. And he's going down to the city. And the Bible said that when he stepped foot into the city, the elders trembled. Because here is a man of God. Here is a prophet of God. He's carrying the word of God in his mouth. This is not no jokey prophet. This is not no overnight prophet. This is a man, glory be to God. If not, he was considered the greatest prophet also in that era. So he's coming with the word of God. He's not coming to tell you what you want to hear. He's coming to tell you, thus saith the Lord. And when he stepped into the city, glory be to God, somehow it happened, he's going to anoint a king. So he's going down now to the house of Jesse. And when he reached the house of Jesse, could you imagine how as a parent, a prophet come into your house and a prophet tell you that, listen, one of your sons is going to be the next king of Israel. And now as a parent, you're going to be excited. You're going to be glad. So now you're going to be calling your children. The Bible said that Jesse had 8 sons, but he called 7 of them forward, leaving David in the backside of the desert, taking care of sheep. So could you now imagine any parent hearing that the son is going to be the king of Israel? They're going to bring their best children forward. They're going to bring their best kids forward. So he brought all his sons before the prophet. And the prophet Samuel now is looking at them and perhaps they presented to Samuel their resume and all the accolades and all the achievement. And the prophet Samuel said, "Surely this is the Lord's anointed." But God spoke to the prophet Samuel and said, "That's not the one." He said, "Man, look at the outward appearance, but I, the Lord, look at the heart." You see, you got to understand, you can't see anointing. You got to discern anointing. You can't dress up anointing. Anointing is not about eloquence and ability to articulate situation. You can't see anointing. You got to discern anointing. And the prophet himself was deceived. The Lord said, "That's not the one. The one that you're looking for is in the backside of the desert." And then they sent to call David. I want you to understand, it doesn't matter where you are. When God appoints you, when God calls you, and when God ready to anoint you, no one could stop it. David wouldn't even call at that particular time. He wasn't even around when the situation, when they called the brothers forward. But I'm telling you, you will never miss your appointment when your appointment is with God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You may miss your appointment with men. But when God appoints you, when God calls you, when God anoints you, you're not going to miss it. He says, "Send for David." And David came being the eighth one because eight represents new beginning. Because God was about to do a new thing in David's life. And not only David's life, in the nation of Israel. I declare to you on this morning that God will do something new in your life. I don't know if you want to receive it or not, but I'm declaring to you that God will do something new in your life. And David came forward. And the Bible said that Samuel anointed David with oil. Now remember, oil represents the anointing, but the anointing is the enablement to fulfill a task. The anointing is the separation, glory be to God, the consecration to be set apart, bless the name of the Lord. So the Bible said when David was anointed, the Spirit of the Lord came upon him from that day forward. But what I pay attention also to, the Bible said that the Spirit of the Lord left Saul and an evil spirit began to trouble him. So from that day forward, David was anointed. But I want you to pay attention. Even though he was anointed, he had to go back into the desert and take care of the sheep. Sometime you may be anointed, glory be to God, for a position that you're not in as yet. But I want you to understand, you don't need to force it. Sometime you might be anointed to lead, glory be to God, but you ought to follow. Sometime you might be anointed to preach, but you ought to back up. Sometimes you might be anointed to sing, glory be to God, but it's okay to do backup singing. And I want you to understand, backing up someone doesn't make you less anointed. You just got to understand when is your appointed time. David was anointed to be king of Israel, but he went back in the backside of the desert, taking care of his father's sheep. And he's in the backside of the desert, I'm telling you. And all of his brothers in the Israel army, some of them, the Bible said that Goliath, the champion of Gath, and Goliath name means exposer, destroyer. He's breathing threat against the army of Israel. And all of Israel's army is scared of this giant. And I want you to understand, nobody could have stepped forward and faced Goliath. In fact, Goliath was Saul's enemy. And David's father realized that something is going on perhaps. And he said, "Listen, go and get something for your brothers to eat." And they take David and send him down to the battlefield. I want you to understand, don't undermine the small task that God is putting in your life. Because your small task, what you take, if you don't undermine it, it's going to take you, it's going to catapult you into your position. Remember what comes with the anointing. There must be responsibility. David was responsible for taking care of his father's sheep. Praise the name of the Lord. There must be maturity. He was mature enough to understand, even though he's anointed king, it's not his time as yet. And there was humility. He wasn't big in his head to say, "You know what? I'm the king of Israel. What are you telling me?" He was still humble enough to go and carry what his brothers need. So can you imagine now what battle is going on? And I don't know if some of you guys watch those adventurous movies like 300 and those Spartan movie and Ellen of Troy or something like that. And you see how it is. It's tension. The enemy can intimidate you. So could you now imagine Israel army with the past reputation that Israel have? the God of Israel. You got to understand that the other nations feared Israel so much because the history that Israel have, it was echoing out throughout the globe at that time. Civilization knew that the God of Israel brought them out of Egypt. And at that time, Egypt was the most powerful and fierce civilization. So if Israel, God could bring them out with a mighty plague, not only bring them out, destroy Egypt, these people is not to mess with. But as time goes by, I'm telling you, it seems like the other nation forget about the reputation of the God of Israel. So they decide to mess with Israel again. Some people forget about your God reputation. They forget how God has moved in your life. So they feel they can mess with you. But I'm telling you, wait and pay attention. You will see what will happen. So David now run down to the battle now. He came down to the battle. And he came to bring his brothers some meal. And when he came to bring the brothers some meal, the brothers and them say, "What are you doing here? Who you left with those sheep in the backside of the desert?" The interesting thing about it is, sometimes the people that you're sent to help, sometimes they are the one could intimidate you. They are the one can make you feel a how. Sometimes the people that you speak good of don't have anything good to say about you. Sometimes the people that you look up to are the ones that look down on you. Sometimes the people that you bless, they are the ones that will try to curse you. David came down, he brought your meal, obedient to what the father said, and his brothers are saying, "What are you doing down here?" David said, "Is not this a cause?" Then after that, not only that, he overheard a conversation with Saul. Saul said, "The person that defeat Goliath is going to be rewarded." David took up the challenge immediately. He said, okay, because David already knew. He received the call of the Lord. He received the appointment and he received the anointing. So this was an opportunity to show all of Israel that there is a God in Israel. Bless the name of the Lord. So now David, now he took up the challenge now. But the thing about it is, even Saul, he dealt with opposition from his brother. Now we have to deal with opposition from the king Saul. The king now is intimidating, and I'm telling him, "Don't you know that you're just a youth? The person that you're going to fight, he's a champion, and he's a champion from young." And on top of that, Saul already discouraging him, and then he said, "Listen, put on my armor. Wear this armor to fight the giant." Sometimes, if you pay attention, Goliath was Saul's giant, and Saul couldn't even kill Goliath with his own armor. Sometimes, folks like to give you advice that did not even work for themselves. This is what Saul was doing. He's giving David some advice, and the advice is not even working for him. I'm telling you, David said, no, I'm not a learned man in this. He was comfortable with a stone and a sling. He dealt with opposition from the brothers. He dealt with opposition from Saul, and now he got to go and deal with opposition against Goliath. I want to tell you on this morning, sometimes opposition don't be easy. Sometimes opposition come in all shape, form, and sizes. But I want you to remember, you are anointed for this. So now he goes before Goliath. And the mistake Goliath make, the Bible said that Goliath, when he saw David coming with a stone and his size, here's what Goliath said: "Am I a dog?" We have heard the saying over and over, never judge a book by its cover. That's what the Bible said. God look at the outward appearance. Man look at the outward appearance, but God look at the heart. Even Goliath get caught up. He is looking at the outward appearance, but he don't know the heart of David. David had the heart. The Bible said that David was a man after God's own heart. And could you imagine, God is fearless, and this is the heart that David is going towards Goliath with. The Bible said that when Goliath charged towards him, David went step forward towards him. And the Bible said the mistake Goliath made, the Bible said that he cursed David by his gods. That was the mistake. Because now you shift the battle from the natural realm into the realm of the spirit. What? Now you're going to remember what Jehovah did for Israel, because you're cursing David by his God. You have to understand now one of the reasons why David picked up a stone. Bless the name of the Lord. First thing first, David chose a stone and a sling because he was skilled with it. Secondly, you got to understand the stone represents rejection. David was a rejected one in his family. Don't you know the stone that the builders has rejected has become the head of the corner? That's why when Jesus was making his triumph in Jerusalem, the Jews wouldn't worship him. He said, "Listen, if they don't worship me, I will cause the rocks to cry out." And in other words, the rocks at that time is interpreted as a Gentile. So what he's saying, if the Jews, my people, will worship me, I will raise up the rejected one, the Gentiles, to worship me. So David now picked a stone, speaking of rejection, the one that was rejected in the backside of the desert, has become the head of the corner. Not only that, according to the law, when you blaspheme against God, you ought to be stoned. Don't you know that when Jesus said to the Jews before Abraham was, I am, the Jews pick up stone to stone him because you say, you being a man, you make yourself God, it's blaspheme. What Goliath did, he blasphemed the God of Israel. So one, I'm going to use a stone which is considered rejected. Two, I'm going to stone you according to the law. If you blaspheme against God, you ought to be stoned. Not only that, a stone is a member of the rock family. And he's dealing with the God of Israel. And we understand that he is the rock of ages. Bless the name of the Lord. And I want you to understand too that David was not no fly by night. If you pay attention to his testimony, he slew the lion and he slew the bear. But if you read the book of Judges, the Bible said that these men were so skilled with swinging a stone. The Bible said the chances of these men missing you when they swing a stone is beneath 1%. In other words, they're not going to miss their target. So could you imagine now? David with a stone and a sling. Bless the name of the Lord. And I believe that God, like he accelerated David into our time and show him our weaponry. Because the Bible said the speed of the stone, when the Holy Ghost connect with the speed of the stone, it's like David was using an AK-47. In other words, Goliath brought a sword to a gunfight. This is how God could do things. This is how God can move in your life. And could you imagine David swinging a stone and Goliath running and charging towards him? Glory be to God. You come to me with your sword and your spear. You come to me with your shield. Glory be to God. You come to me in your own strength. You come to me in your own might. You come to me in your own power. But I come to you in the name of the Lord. And I believe David wrote Psalms 23 and he was reciting that. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointed my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The Bible said that the stone pierced Goliath in the center of his head. Because the head now represents the stronghold. The head now is where everything is in operation. The head, whatever head it is, whatever stronghold it is in your life, lie, deceit, backbiting, gossip, whatever it is, that the head, the Bible said that David took a stone and slew Goliath, fell to the ground. The Bible said he took off his head. He didn't have a sword, but he used the enemy's own sword and took off his head. But I want you to understand, Goliath was just his first giant, and now he had to deal with Saul, which was more a difficult giant. Now he had to deal with Saul, because after killing Goliath, after, glory be to God, defeating the giant, the ladies get him in trouble. They began to sing a song. They say, Saul killed 1,000 and David killed 10,000. And now the Bible said, glory be to God, Saul heard about it and Saul became angry. Saul became mad. The Bible said that the evil spirit began to provoke Saul. And the Bible said he began to throw javelin at David. I want you to understand that the throwing of javelin at that time was a king's sport. So when they're throwing a javelin, it wasn't a miss or maybe. These men were skilled at throwing javelin. But I want you to understand, the spirit of the Lord had already left Saul and is upon David. So it doesn't matter how much javelin you throw at somebody who God has anointed. You're going to miss. Hallelujah. I said, it doesn't matter how much javelin you throw at the anointed. The Bible said every javelin that was thrown at David, glory be to God, Saul missed. And I came to tell you on this morning, I want you to understand that you are anointed. You are anointed. You are anointed for your circumstances. You are anointed for what you're going through. You are anointed for what you're dealing with. Because of the anointing, the yoke shall be destroyed. And that's why Jesus declared, he said, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because he had anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He had anointed me to set at liberty to them that are captive. He anointed me to bring sight to the blind. He anointed me to heal the brokenhearted. And Peter said, how God anointed Jesus with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good, healing all those who were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. I want you to understand that what you're dealing with on this morning, you are anointed for it. Shake yourself. Move in power. Walk in authority. Stop acting defeated because you are anointed. You gotta understand, when God anoints you, he enables you. Sometimes we come in, life situation can have us overwhelmed. Life situation can have us down. Life situation can have us, But you don't know the anointing, hallelujah. You don't know that the anointing destroyed the yoke. Don't you know that God anoint you for this? Hallelujah. Don't you know that God chose you for this? Glory be to God. Don't you know that God has specialized you to deal with such situation? How do I know? Because what they're dealing with, somebody else would have died. Because what they're dealing with, somebody else would end up in a mental institution. Because what you're dealing with, somebody else, hallelujah, would have quit. But you're still standing today. You're still in your right mind. You still can give God praise. You still know who you are. You still can call upon God. You could still say hallelujah. You could still say thank you, Jesus, because you're anointed. Hallelujah. If I was to bring it into the New Testament, hallelujah. Glory be to God, we are anointed. The Bible said that the Holy Ghost is the one who anoints you. And time will fail me to tell you what happened in the book of Acts. When the anointing comes, when the anointing moves, hallelujah, you got to understand, you can't put a yoke on who God has anointed. That situation ought not to yoke you. That problem ought not to yoke you. What you're dealing with ought not to yoke you. You can't put a yoke on who God has anointed. Anoint, because the anointing destroys the yoke. So why are you still in your yoke? Why are you still in your yoke? Why are you still depressed? Why are you still sad? Why are you still down and out when God has anointed you for this? Praise the name of the Lord. Clap your hands for Jesus. I want you to understand. Hallelujah. Let it register in your mind. Let it register in your heart. Let it register in your spirit that God has anointed you. It doesn't matter who you are anointed. Stop looking at yourself as nobody. See yourself as who God sees you as. See yourself as a child of God. See yourself as somebody with authority. See yourself as somebody that has power. See yourself as a child of the king. See yourself as somebody that God will use to destroy giants. Goliath breathing threat, nowhere in the Bible I saw David was crying. So why are you crying? Why are you crying in front of Goliath? Nowhere in the Bible. In fact, David had word to Goliath. He said, today I will feed I'll feed your flesh to the birds of the air and the beasts of the field. David wasn't making joke. You gotta look at your giant in that face. In the New Testament, Jesus says, speak to that mountain, speak to it. Tell it to remove. What is the giant in your life on this morning? What has been harassing you on this morning? What has been disturbing you on this morning? Speak to that giant. Or else, if you don't want to speak to it, give it the stone. You playing, man. You're joking, man. Circumstance arise. Situation arise. Things getting out of hand. And you want to wrap up in a corner. You go and hide in. No, not with your giants. I said, not with your giants. And there's a song that say, giants, they do die. The bigger they are, the harder they fall. I want you to understand, if you would just speak to that giant, stone that giant, because it's time for that giant to come down. The devil is a liar. Don't make no giant intimidate you. What it is blowing. Sickness, speak to it. Disease, speak to it. Whatever it is that's coming in your way, remember who you are as a child of God. Remember that you are anointed for it. Remember that God called you for it. Remember that God chose you for it. And if God, this is what I want you guys to understand. The anointing is the enablement to complete the task. If the task is not complete, that means you got some work to do because you need to complete it. Don't leave it undone. Saul didn't complete his task. And because of that, God rejected him. Because you know why? God placed the anointing upon him, but he didn't complete his task. But David, he completed the task that God had anointed him to do. And on this morning, I want to pray for you that you will complete the task that God has anointed you to do. And Jesus. At times you might feel down, but I want you to understand the anointing will destroy the yoke. Bless the name of the Lord. Hi there, is this your first time? Can you put your hands together for her? What's your name?
Bella.
Bella, it's nice having you, Bella. Hallelujah. Is it okay if I can pray for you?
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Good Father, it's who